worship service, First United Methodist Church of Fort Natchez. I'm glad you're here. I welcome you in the name of Jesus Christ. I'm glad that you're here with us via Facebook Live, and ask you to do a couple things. You can like us or comment or say you're here, and we'll be able to see who's joining us that way. Also, this morning, I wanted to have a couple of announcements. One is that we are doing a few things on Zoom to keep connected in other ways than just worship. So at 8 o'clock every morning, we're having a Zoom devotional. And actually, everybody in the church that we have an email address from should actually have that invitation in their mailbox. And then also on Monday evenings, we're starting tonight a new Bible study. It's called Life Lessons from Philippians. It's about joy. And that starts at 6:30 tonight. You also, if we have your email address, should have an invitation to that. So if you didn't get an invitation and you wanted to come, you might just like maybe private message us this morning with your email, and we'll make sure you get that link that you could join us. And then today, also at 2 o'clock, one of our Sunday school classes is going to launch their Sunday school class via Zoom. And I know those folks in that Sunday school class have gotten emails from them with the link in it. But again, if you want to be a part of that study that they're doing on the book of John, I'm sure they would welcome anybody to do that with them. You might put that also in a private message if you want to be a part of that. But with those things said, the peace of the Lord Jesus Christ be with you, and also with you. Let's begin with our call to worship for this morning. Our hope for a new creation is not tied to what humans can do. For we believe that one day every challenge to God's rule will be crushed. God's kingdom will fully come and the Lord will rule. We long for the day when our bodies are raised, the Lord wipes away our tears, and we dwell forever in the presence of God. We will take our place in the new creation. Whereas there will be no more death or mourning or crying or pain, and the Lord will be our light. Come, Lord Jesus, come. And if you'll join us in our opening hymn, if you happen to have a hymnal at home, it's hymn number 384. The word should probably be going into your feed right now. For love divine, all loves excelling, and I invite you to sing.
Thank you.
we prayed this morning, I forgot to tell you that Poppy is recovering from knee surgery, and so Jenny Houston has graciously agreed to help us out with the music this morning, and we thank her for that. I appreciate her willingness always to fill in everywhere she's needed and to be a part of worship. But now let us join our hearts together in prayer. Lord, we are such a ragtag group of people. Some of us are at the top of our game, and others just struggle to get through each day. Yet, you draw us here where we can find friendship, peace, and hope, not only for our lives right now, but for all the times to come. Stand us up again, O God, dust us off, and put us back on the pathways of service and reconciliation. Warm our hearts with your love. Lift our spirits with your power. For we ask these things in the name of Jesus Christ, our Savior, who taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. So today we continue in our study that we're doing from the worship series that we're doing from the 8th chapter of Romans. And I want you to listen for a fresh new word to get today from Romans 8, beginning with verse 12. Hear now the word of the Lord. So then, brothers and sisters, we have an obligation, but it isn't an obligation to ourselves to live out our lives on the basis of selfishness. If you live on the basis of selfishness, you are going to die. But if you put to death the actions of the body with the spirit, you will live. All who are led by God's spirit are God's sons and daughters. You did not receive a spirit of slavery to lead you back again into fear, but you received a spirit that shows you are adopted as his children. With this spirit, we cry, Abba, Father. The same spirit agrees with our spirit that we are God's children. But if we are children, we are also heirs. We are God's heirs and fellow heirs with Christ if we really suffer with him, so that we can also be glorified with him. I believe that the present suffering is nothing compared to the coming glory that is going to be revealed to us. The whole creation waits breathless with anticipation for the revelation of God's sons and daughters. Creation was subject to frustration not by its own choice. It was the choice of the one who subjected it, but in the hope that the creation itself will be set free from slavery to decay and brought into the glorious freedom of God's children. We know that the whole creation is groaning together and suffering labor pains up until now. And it's not only the creation, we ourselves who have the Spirit as the first crop of the harvest also groan inside as we wait to be adopted and for our bodies to be set free. We were saved in hope. If we see what we hope for, that is hope. Who hopes for what they already see? But if we hope for what we don't see, we wait for it with patience. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. And now if you'll join us in singing My Hope Is Built. And it's, again, if you have a hymnal, it's on page 368. If not, the words will be coming up on your feet, and sing with us. My what he says, of course, in some light. But the way this translation, I think, reads it or writes it is a better way of saying what Paul really meant to say in those days or said in those days in a different language. But in the context of our text for this morning, we could maybe reinterpret a little bit and say, if you live according to the self, you're going to die. But if you live by the Spirit, in other words, that Spirit that tells us to love God and love others, and you put to death our desires of ourself all of the time and to be in isolation, then you'll live. So that thought, which of course in older translations say you live by the flesh or you live by the Spirit, but in the CEB it really kind of talks about that selfishness of living in a way where we only really think about ourselves. Okay, maybe that doesn't really flow quite as well as Paul's prose does, but I think it helps us to kind of really think about acknowledging our obligations. Our obligations to God and our obligations to all kind of things. What the old translations would say, we had debts. We were debtors. And we're not in debt to ourselves. I've heard, people say recently, you owe it to yourself. You owe it to yourself to do this, or you owe it to yourself to take a vacation, or you owe it to yourself to buy that car you wanted. You owe it to yourself. Well, the truth is that this scripture would tell you, you don't owe it to yourself. In fact, what we owe is that we are in debt to each other. We're in debt to those who have brought us into relationship with God. We are in debt mostly to the God who loves us and cares for us and created us. We are debtors. In one way to think about it is to love. We are debtors to love. We are debtors to the Spirit who shaped us, who claimed us, who offers us a future with hope. We are debtors to those who helped us to experience the Spirit more vividly and who walked beside us and behind us and maybe led us in different ways to Sunday school teachers and family and parents and all those others who have brought us through. We have a debt. We have a debt of love to be what they called us to be and to be what God calls us to be. Thus, we are in debt to the God who guides us and shapes us and loves us beyond anything that we can imagine. I think that's what Paul is saying. And we are all debtors. We like to think that we're free and unfettered and that we are bound together in some ways, but mostly we'd like to be free. But I think what Paul is trying to tell us is we are bound together in the Christian community more than we can ever imagine. And the truth is that we are better off that way because that's the way God intended it. We are able to reach our fullest best self when we are the exact best self that God created us to be. And we are blessed to live and to be in community with one another and to take care of. And that's where the debt lies. It's our privilege, Paul says, to suffer in the service of those relationships. It's what we should do. We should feel good about the fact that we suffer. It's not just the human relationships that we're indebted to, but we are in relationship with all creation. That's when Paul turns the corner a little bit in this passage, and he says the whole creation that we are indebted to, and he gives us this vivid picture of the whole creation groaning in labor pains, hurting and bringing forth what God had always intended for creation. That the world and the creation still is in that process of all the difficulty that you have to go through to give birth to the wonderful things that we find in this world. And of course, we say he's talking spiritually, and certainly he is, but I wonder sometimes if that's, also he's talking literally about the kind of bondage and the kind of ways that we are tempting to harm creation and to do harm to what God had intended us to do. And he would, I think, say to us that the fate of the world, the fate of the planet, is woven into our fate and into our future and even into our hope. And so all creation, which is what the term this sermon is named, creation waits. It waits for that time when, fully birthed in what God had created, we can bring about that by being children of God. Not only that, but all that God has made relies on us. Not just us, but our better selves, that self, our true selves, our lives as sons and daughters of God, as adopted children of God. Which is a roundabout way of saying that we treat our world as though it were a part of God and as a part of us. Now, don't misunderstand me. I am not saying that nature is God or creation is God. That's an important distinction to make. We don't worship creation. We aren't tree worshipers and mountain disciples. We're not grass gurus, any kind of grass by that definition even. We're not, you know, flora and fauna followers. We're followers of Jesus Christ, the Messiah, who came and taught us about the God and the creator of the universe. And we are worshipers of the creator, not the creation. And all that we see and all that we are, creation, is not God. Yet we get a glimpse of the creator when we comprehend creation. You know, I was a commercial art major in college, and I took art history. And what I found out is that when we know the artists and we can and examine the work that they do, we have a better understanding of who the artist was. And I think that when we communicate with the author, in somebody who's written a book or whatever, we have a better understanding of his writing when we have a chance to know them better through actually reading. And so as we experience creation, as we become a part of creation, guess what? We know the Creator better. And in this possibility of being in that kind of a communication with God, I would say all creation waits for a time when the kingdom of God comes in this place as it is in heaven. And the truth is, there's some urgency in what we do. The truth is that we're not getting better on our own. And we need to take an active part in building the kingdom of God. And for that, all creation waits. Amen. Today, because this is a traditional service, we do those things that we typically do in a traditional service, and that is that we will affirm our faith using the words of the Apostles' Creed. I invite you to join us in that, and then we'll sing the Gloria Patri just like we do here in church. But I ask you to join me now in those historic words. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he arose from the dead, he ascended into heaven, and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and life everlasting. Amen. Oh, let thou Now, I'd just like to take a moment to talk about our giving. And one of our obligations, of course, is to give of our tithes and offerings. And I want to thank all of those who continue to give faithfully in many ways. I just want to remind you that, you know, you can still, of course, give by mailing a check to us at First United Methodist Church, P.O. Box 277, Port Neches, Texas, 77651. Also, you can go to our webpage, fumcportneches.org, and right there on the landing page, if you just scroll down a little bit, right in the middle of that page is a link that says online giving, and you can go there. And then also we've added the ability to do text to give, which allows you to text a number, which is 855-577-5311. And when you text that number, you can, once you set it up, once you put in your bank information, your debit card, your credit card, whatever you want to use, all you have to do is text that number and a blank will come up and say how much, and you put that number in there and you give, and you're done in about 15 seconds. So lots of great ways of giving. But most of all, I want to give thanks to God and thanks to you for the continued support for this church and its ministries during this difficult time. And so the appropriate thing to do is sing the doxology to God.
Thank you.
Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit go with you